Hi, welcome. Josh Hanrahan here. Mark Morri's with me. We are the crime team behind the Daily Telegraph documentaries, The War and The War 2.
And Young Bloods, don't forget that one.
Young Bloods, yeah. Postcode Wars, that's another one. And we're here today to answer your questions. Moz, this is a bit of a new thing for us. We're used to doing the podcast and doing our weekly TikTok, but now we're in the hands of the audience.
And we're live, so we've got to be a little bit careful about how we respond.
Yeah, we do. Imagine. Yes, particularly on some of the topics that we're going to talk about. We'll just start. Obviously, I gather if you're here watching, then you've probably seen some of the stuff and are aware of what's been happening in Sydney's underworld in the past few years. But Moz, over your career, I ask you this question a bit, but is this the biggest gang war you've seen?
It's the most public gang war, so it's not the biggest in a way, because they're all big. But I mean, there was that period when literally every 6 weeks there was somebody being killed. But back in the 80s, a similar thing was happening, but a lot quieter. You didn't have cars being set on fire and CCTV. So I'm saying it's up there. It's definitely up there. And as I said, it's a little bit more indiscriminate. The shootings are public. They're in gyms. We've seen, you know, even in the last 10 years, people shot at shopping centres, Wally Ahmed. But we have had we had ones where they were going to use a rocket launcher to kill an enemy, and luckily they decided against it. So yeah, it's getting there.
Yeah, we've had 20 murders so far, countless kidnappings.
Oh yeah,
you know, there's
so many of them we don't hear about. They're weekly occurrences.
Yeah, there's been so much going on, and on that topic, we've got a really hard hitting question to start with, Moz.
Yep.
I've worded you up before this and said be careful what you say, because you do have a tendency to get a bit loose. So this is from an anonymous person. They want to know how many pairs of shoes you own.
Look, I have quite a few pairs of shoes, but I only keep one pair for public appearances.
I think
my favourite brown ones.
That, and you're wearing them today?
That's right.
And
until they wear out.
There's always plenty of comments on our TikToks about our fashion.
Yes.
My favourite story is one that I was telling earlier, and I'm going to throw you under the bus about when you turned up to an interview with what you thought was a radio.
I thought it was the ABC radio on a Sunday morning, yes.
And so you wore a singlet, but it wasn't radio, was it?
No, it was TV. And it wasn't a singlet. It was a kind of very loose-fitting kind of top. But anyway, I carried it off.
You always do. You always do. Okay, then we got a question here from Matt, who says, this is one we get a bit. Mm-hmm. Do you guys ever get scared doing all these reports, and have you ever been threatened?
It's funny. The more public that the media gets, especially like, you know, as I said, I started on a typewriter. No one really knew what you looked like. The one time, you know, there was a guy who in a hotel obviously had some friends in the common chair. I wasn't very happy with me. In a pub.
Yeah.
Surrey Hills put me in a kind of a friendly headlock, but it wasn't really. The other time was walking through Broadway Shopping Centre, and this guy who kind of looked like Mount Kosciuszko with a head. He was huge with the lightning tattoos. And he said, senior. And he tapped me on the shoulder and said, stay safe. And that's the least way I felt after he'd done that. So yeah, it's sometimes a little bit, but I think I think the same things happened to you. You know, you had a bit of a time. There was during the making of the first documentary, and there was some people who almost tried to extort you. It wasn't there in a way.
Yeah, I think it was probably blown out of proportion a bit. I think they'd, you know, had a bit of a big night and maybe got a bit carried away. But you know, there was that time, as I think we've spoken about plenty on Crim City, the podcast, when we caught wind through the police. They came to us and said, "Look, we've heard some threats that are."
They said they're not
super, you know, it's not life threatening, but let's just be safe and cautious. And
and we were safe and cautious, and the company's expense at a very nice hotel. It was good.
Yeah, it was great. Yeah. But look, I think that question we get asked a lot is, do you get scared, and, you know, do you ever worry that they'll come? And I've said this a bit, and I know talking to people who are in that world, they say, well, you guys aren't, you know, I know
They're not going to spend half a million dollars trying to knock us.
It probably seems to the average person like we're heavily involved in that world, but we're really not. And the biggest thing is that we've seen with all these murders is that they're business related, right?
Invariably, or serious revenge. There's some deep personal history or hatred or something. But kicked off invariably by money, and then it becomes tit for tat and ego. But you're right, they're business decisions, and there's a lot of money nowadays to do the modern day hit, as I say. Yeah. And that's something that, you know, we've talked about back when I'm talking about the hits in the 80s, there used to be the sole hitman.
Yeah.
Now I think we've found with the Alen Moradian's murder is a prime example. Police have arrested 8 people that they allege were involved. 8.
Mm. So it's a big crew.
Whereas, as I said years ago, the guy used to steal the car, drive the car. He might have a driver. You'd have maybe 2 at most, and then go and shoot the guy in the middle of the night and take off. But now it's a major operation. There was cars that are stolen and hidden, and there are people facilitating guns. It's a big thing.
Yeah, it's funny. I remember a cop said to me not too long ago, they said, well, because I raised that with him. I said, we always get asked that question. I said, why should you guys be worried? I said, we should be more worried. We're the ones out there locking them up. We're the ones that are responsible for trying to take them down. Yeah. So I thought that was a good point.
Yeah.
Another anonymous question here, and they say, this is probably a good one for you, Moz, because growing up, you know, if you've watched Scarface, if you've watched The Godfather, the Italian Mafia is a big deal, and they say, where is the Italian Mafia in all of this? They seem to drive most importations but never get mentioned.
That's a really good point, because they were huge. They were very much on the media's radar in the 70s, 80s, even perhaps 90s. They seem to have learned, and they've taken a bit of a back step, but you're quite right. I think you'll find the federal police still have a brief, and they're in contact very much with the Italian authorities. So the mafia, they just don't seem to be getting caught. Well, having said that, we literally have somebody who's caught today with that latest raid by the New South Wales Crime Commission and the Organised Crime Squad.
Yep.
And there's a well-known Italian name in there, which we won't mention today because he hasn't been in court yet. And they were caught with about $4 million worth of unexplained wealth, basically.
Yeah. And it was interesting, when that came through, you said to me, is it out at Griffith?
Yeah, because the name was just synonymous with some of those families that I've been hearing back from 70s and 80s. So making a very good point, they aren't getting the profile they used to. The Middle Eastern guys have taken over that. I think the Italian Mafia, we know, is supplying worldwide. They are still supplying a lot of MDMA, particularly. And I still think you'll find that they're behind a lot of the grass trade, you know, that's around Australia.
There's a question here from Kath, who says, how do you guys get into the zone before a nerve-wracking job? Any music that you listen to? I don't know that our job is regularly too nerve-wracking, but it's an interesting question. It's probably more nerve-wracking for the police who are, you know, going through to barge through a door. I don't know.
You've been on a few of those, haven't you?
Been on a few of those, and they have some songs that they like to play before they...
What was one you said that... Do they play?
I can't remember its name off the top of my head, but... it's probably more a thing for them. We don't really tend to get too amped. It's not like going out onto the footy field.
The only time you get a bit nervous after, when you know something's going to print, and it's the next day, who are you going to upset?
Yeah.
And that could be a cop or a crook. Because sometimes, you know, the police aren't always very happy with what we run as well. Because sometimes they, you know, they'd like to keep a lot of, they'd like to keep certain, they'd like to believe, they don't even like the term war, many of them. They hate us saying that there's a gang war.
Yeah.
They like, you know, words like conflict.
Yes. But, only time I think you get anything close to nerve-wracking, and to be honest, it probably isn't so much something that happens when we're talking about topics like this, because, you know, we're often dictated to if something's happened, then we're just reporting it. But it's when you get wind of a big story that you're sitting on for a little bit as you're trying to firm it up. But, you know, who knows what it might be. It's not normally underworld related, I guess I'm saying. And don't know, tentatively, say if you're holding it for a couple of days as you try to firm it up, you're checking every other.
You're more scared that you're going to get
that someone else has got it.
Like someone else is going to pinch your story, not get knocked off.
There's a question here from Lebo Memes.
Oh, yeah.
They say, criminals, including those involved in conflicts and individuals mentioned in your articles, may use your content as intelligence. Thoughts on this statement?
I'm trying to figure... Like,
I think it's there's a couple of things come to mind. The first thing is that police are often talking to us about... It's funny because they put it in court papers, right? But then if we report it, there's sometimes they don't like it and they call it methodology, you know. So essentially, whether they had listening devices, you know, what else it might be, if they had an inside source. So that they sometimes say, oh, why did you print that? That gives us our, you know, it's in the court
documents. I do remember one that talking about listening devices where actually a police woman actually had listening devices in her bra.
Really?
Yeah. And I actually went to write it in a book and she said, oh, maybe you better not. But when I spoke to the defence lawyer, he said, no, we knew all about it because it was in court documents.
Yeah.
And anyway, the batteries didn't work and they didn't record any of the conversation. So, but yeah.
Yeah, I think another thing is that there was that crazy time in the middle of 2021 or 22, where there was a spate of alleged murders, with starting with Brownie Ahmed, Omar Zahed, Rami Iskander, and then Yusuf Nazlioglu. And around that time, we began to hear a lot about bounties on the heads of criminals. You know, there was Tariq Zahed
and Brownie was quite openly.
They know about it. The police has gone to them, but I think after we reported on some of the bounties, and then they came, you know, unfortunately, they were carried out.
Yes.
We went, okay, we're not going to write about that. And we spoke with the police about it. They said, look, it's not your fault. You're not, you know, causing them to do this, but just, you don't need to do it. If you cannot do it, don't do it. And we haven't done it since then.
No, we haven't. And there's there'd be four or five guys out there who know, and they're big names, who would have $2 million hits. We actually have reported recently on Andre, you know, I always get his name wrong.
Kalita.
Who allegedly had a contract out on his life,
mm-hmm.
and he still believes there's one out, even though police have arrested people who they say were going to be involved in killing him outside Day Street Police Station.
Yes. And we reported that because that is one of the most audacious plots to kill anybody.
I've never heard of
it. We almost couldn't believe it when we first heard that was what was planned.
We'd heard it before we actually had it verified, didn't we? It was almost rumour. And then now we've seen that police will allege that, and it's in court documents. So we're not saying, speaking out of school, that he was going to be killed.
There's another allegedly. Anonymous question from the street dealer selling directly to the consumer, to the syndicate importing the drugs. How many levels are there in the drug supply chain?
That is really...
It's a great question.
It is a great question and really hard to answer.
Well, normally they break it down into three. High, mid-level and low level.
Yeah, but there's different... Every organisation will have different...
But then above the high level, there's bigger guys.
Super high.
And then below the low level, there's probably, you know, even other people that you don't hear of. So, I don't know. It could be...
We have to go and do some homework.
It's a good question.
Because you actually have, you know, we've seen before, you will have, like now we currently would have the head of perhaps the Hells Angels, right, bringing gear into Australia. He is offshore, all right, and he's wanted. Angela Pandeli is wanted here in Australia. He's commonly referred to as the head of the Hells Angels. Then that would be getting shipped here to his underlings,
mm-hmm.
who then will be spreading it out. So
I guess the question is, how far removed are they from your bloke at a pub on a Saturday night buying a bag of cocaine?
Hugely.
Often not only in the chain of things, but also in kilometres. They're probably tens of thousands of kilometres away overseas.
We know there are so many people they've been going offshore because, one, the cops here have been pretty good at their job. Mm-hmm. And they're very worried that they're going to be arrested. They're going over there. But there are still some guys here making huge money living here in Sydney and the rest of Australia, but particularly Sydney, who are still quite far removed. mm-hmm. but still getting the big dollars. And mm-hmm. the street dealers are the ones carrying all the risk. Yes. And we've seen those dialer dealers getting picked up regularly. The cops are nailing them. You know?
Totally. Emma asks, do you see an end to the war? It seems as though one crime family comes down and another rises up just as quickly. I think having, you know, had the great joy of spending most days working alongside you for the past number of years, I've heard a lot about the previous wars.
Sometimes you don't listen to me about some of my previous war stories. Boom, boom. Yeah.
Yeah, I do the first time, but when they're repeated regularly. Yeah. And I guess where I was kind of going there was that, yeah, this iteration of Sydney's gang conflict may, you know, whittle away with the players that we're seeing, you know, or have seen in recent years at some point. I don't know if that'll be soon, but that is what we've seen over the years. You know, you talk about the Razzics and the Darwiches,
and then
the Ahmeds, these families that and, you know, even the Hamsies, you know, that are at one point the big boys in the yard, and then over time it doesn't, you know, the game that they're in, it's not one that's really for longevity most of the time.
And what can especially reignite when you talk about the Razzics and Darwiches, which was back in 2000 or so. That was over 10 years later, somebody got out of jail and went and killed another one of the family.
Yeah.
Now, with the Hamsies and the Ahmeds and the Elmirs, there are a few people locked up who are going to get out. Now, that can sometimes spark, reignite mm-hmm. an old war. So.
Do you see an end to it? I would have to say no, and that is only because of what, I guess, what we cover in, you know, the war too. You look, and that's recent. It's current.
And
you look at the tensions that are out there, and you know, these are like Andre Kalita.
Yeah.
You know, these alleged, that's on Christmas last year. It feels like Christmas was yesterday. I know it's April now, but, you know, that's Christmas Day last year that they're...
The murder of Alen Moradian, the alleged murder, we know that sparked a lot of bad blood between lots of people. And so, you know, the end to this war, it'll just evolve into another war potentially.
But even police admit that. They say, look, you know, they've done, and full credit to them, a great job in probably the past 18 months with Task Force Magnus, as tensions escalated after Moradian's death.
Yeah.
They suppressed a lot, but then they said that we can't stop it forever because...
Well, there was the murder just recently of the brother of the man accused of killing Alen Moradian.
Yeah.
Now, that didn't get a lot of publicity because there was news going around, but that's... Here is a guy supposedly not involved... And why is he being killed?
Yeah, that just happened to be at the same time as the alleged double murder by the police officer.
Yeah, that's right.
So that's a lot of things got lost that week. But, I mean, police say while there's drugs being dealt on the streets and there's a market
there. The amount of money, again, is just mind-boggling that they're making. You know, I think it was recently saying $1 million a week one of those syndicates was making, wasn't it?
Yeah, the Alamedines were making $1 million a week off some phones. I mean, that's tax-free too. That's the best bit.
It's a lot more than I get.
How do you get your information so early, and how do you verify it? The verifying's a good one. I think it's probably something we've spoken about on the podcast before. And I know, I mean, unfortunately, in recent years, there's been lots of examples where there has been shootings late at night, and we get a call from somebody saying, and it depends. We speak to people all over the place, right? And sometimes we just get random tips now.
That's
which
right.
is great.
Yeah.
And if anybody's out there and they know something, and they want to tip us off randomly, you know, feel free. And anonymously, feel free. But there is always that, you know, say it comes from somebody who's not in the police, we would then normally go to the police and try and confirm it because... one thing we want to do is always make sure that we're right.
That's right. And I remember that night, the big night in question was the shooting of Omar Zahed and Tariq Zahed.
Yes.
Now, the underworld was on fire. I mean, our phones were just going crazy with that, and that was coming from but everybody was saying that Tariq was dead.
Yeah.
I remember. And
we were approaching a print deadline, to get the paper out for the next day.
And there were people absolutely convinced, but we couldn't confirm then until we actually got it right. And we actually went to print with the fact that only Omaha had been done. But we went to the police. When we have so much, we actually, it's not until it's actually 100% confirmed with police, invariably. Although, I remember with the death of Erkan Keskin over in Turkey, who was the head of the Lone Wolf, I got the information, and no one here could confirm it, but I was so confident of the sources that had told me that he had died, that we went with it. And that wasn't, you know, that was a different jurisdiction, but we really make sure we're 100% right, and invariably that's, don't you think, we wait till the police tell us, or
yes,
somebody so close to a victim that we... Or,
yeah, totally. Know,
perhaps a family member or even...
Yeah, it is an important... We do take that very seriously.
And we haven't got anything wrong that I know of lately.
Where do Asian gangs fit into the Sydney underworld? I was actually speaking to somebody about this yesterday, and I said, we don't write a lot about Asian crime, because one of the reasons is that in the modern world that we live in, be it TikTok, be it, you know, the website, be it the newspaper, we need photos. And these guys are often laying so low, they don't have social media profiles, they don't have an Instagram. There's no way for us to be able to illustrate the story. So, which makes it far less interesting to look at.
And like our question before, like with the Italians, they keep very, very low profiles. And they have traditionally, although, you know, but they're out there, they're very big. Vietnamese are considered to be still supplying a lot of, they do the hydro houses out there for our dope. Recently, there was just a 17 kilo haul of heroin in Chinatown that police are looking at. So they are very active there in the importation of drugs. And they're also very big in the facilitation of money movement, Asian crime gangs.
Yeah, totally.
But again, you're right. We don't say a lot about it because we don't have, they don't use a lot of social media, but it's also, they're more culturally keep a lower profile.
Mm-hmm. This is a question, again, we get asked a bit, not one that we normally discuss, but I know people raise it. This question says, how have they cut the head off the snake with the Alamedin OCN, which is the claim that police made back in 2022 when they ran what they called Strike Force Sugarcane, which
one
was
of your favourites.
Yeah, oh, it was just a massive one. I remember that day. It was another crazy day.
The police are very, very proud of that one, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. And essentially that sugarcane was all about taking out the street level drug supply that the Alamedins had controlled in Sydney. So anyway, and the big claim, Karen Webb got up at a press conference and said, we've cut the head off the snake. And so this question says, how can they claim that they've cut the head off the snake when most will receive bail, like always? Is it to keep the public calm under false claims?
You've looked into sugarcane pretty heavily, so what do you think?
Yeah, so it's interesting because everybody they arrested under sugarcane, bar one person, is back on the streets.
Wow.
That was right as of about a fortnight ago, but that may
it's
have now
kind of supporting that, that.
Well, yeah, it's a reasonable question, but that may have now changed because police have now done what I'm essentially calling sugarcane 2.0. They're calling it Strike Force Wessex, which is another attempt to, you know, we saw it last week. They arrested more than a dozen people they allege are involved in the Alamedin crime clan and their drug supply network.
And again, dollar dealers, isn't it? It's
but the issue is that, it's not an issue, but I guess it essentially all comes down to being able to prove, you know, police know what they know, but it's what they can prove in court. And so what you see a lot of the time is, especially with the way the courts go, is that they're cutting deals. And that's I don't think there's anything wrong with that from a policing perspective.
But it's still, it is disrupting.
It is big
and
time.
It disrupts their money supply. Costs them lots of money to go to court. They get very, very expensive lawyers. So from that policing perspective, they'll say they've been quite successful. Mm-hmm. I think, I don't know, you talk to people, it doesn't seem to have disrupted the supply of cocaine on the streets from what I can gather.
Yeah, not sure.
That's just what people are saying. It's still a lot out there. It's just a non-stop sort of cycle.
Yes. Where are we here? this is another. There's a bit of interest in the Italian mafia. Australian Steve says links between the Ndrangheta. That's always a hard one, even for me to say.
And I'm Italian background, but I'm not.
Yeah,
failed. I can't even.
Ndrangheta clans and bikers go back to Fat Frank Barbaro and his nephew Pass. This is going to be one that you're going to have to answer.
Yeah, and very Melbourne based there, he's talking about. And,
are they still there, or are OMCG linking directly with cartels?
They're moving more directly with cartels. In fact, there are people even over in Mexico now, Australians working in Mexico, making links with the cartels directly there, and they're mainly the bikies. The Italian mafia, and as I said, aren't as high profile as they used to be. Mm-hmm. And I think the bikies have become their own network now, and they are making their own, you know, their own connections overseas, and we've seen that. A lot of them have all been operating from overseas. Mm-hmm. There's still a huge amount of Comanchero in Dubai.
Well,
and going backwards and forwards, you've got
the world. The world commander of the Comanchero is apparently in Spain. There's definitely international links. This is a question from another anonymous person, which says, where is the loyalty these days? Back in the day, there was no patching over.
Yeah, they're just 100% right. Patching over was almost considered a death sentence. You know, guys, if you patched over, you were sometimes kidnapped and had your tattoos branded off.
Yeah.
So,
very Sons of Anarchy, though. You know,
and they're actually talking now, there's a lot of people patching over to the Hell's Angels as we speak, who are making a real play. But yeah, there is none of that loyalty at all.
That's probably a bit to do too with bikie gangs becoming more like professional.
They're businesses.
Drug networks, really, aren't they? You know,
they're crime syndicates so much.
It's not like the club where you go and, you know, hang out with you. You know, it's not like your local footy club. Yeah,
they don't have clubhouses. In New South Wales, they don't have clubhouses because the minute they open up, they get dismantled by Raptor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally. Do the Assyrians still hold influence these days?
Well, I think that's clearly been demonstrated by the statue of Alen Moradian, you know. And
even if you look the other day, I the story that we ran on Tuesday's paper, which is about the death of a Sphinx bikie.
That's right. Yes.
Who in February was shot dead. And
while
then,
attempting to steal.
Yeah, it was essentially he was attempting to break into the home of I don't know who it is, but it's some bloke with links to an Assyrian crime gang apparently, who had the Sphinx had got word that he had $250,000 sitting in his house somewhere, and so Jamie Goodworth, who's the dead bikie and a crew of guys were trying to break in and steal it, and anyway, it cost him his life. So clearly, if you got $250,000 sitting around in your lounge room, you must be doing all right.
You're a major player in some area.
Can we get an update on this person's clearly a keen Crim City listener, or maybe they saw the TikToks where you had your arm in a sling? Can we get an update on Moz's shoulder?
Yeah. It's nearly been a year since I went out fact-finding till midnight and fell over, breaking my shoulder, where I've got about 10 pins. Yeah, I've got a lot of movement now, and I haven't yet... I can swim, but so it's pretty funny. It's on the mend.
It's pretty funny that people ask, are we worried about, you know, big bad bikies, and what was it, a telephone pole was really the biggest...
No, well, it depends. I have got a really impressive scar there depending on who asks.
Well, keep your shirt on, please.
Okay, you're right. I can become an OnlyFans. Is that what they do? No,
sorry. That'll...
That was close.
No. I just hope that day never comes.
Yeah.
What else have we got here? There's plenty. There is plenty of questions. It's very good. There's a question about the decor in Alen Moradian's house. I don't know...
In the old house.
Yeah, that's
incredible. And there's some legal problems as well, too, with that.
That's incredible stuff, that is. How much of this war is the Sydney Commission?
I think initially a lot of it. invariably. And again, there's little legal restrictions because a whole lot of people are being charged and still facing. But I think we all know that it started off somebody believing that they'd been robbed. I think a lot of the kidnappings are down to the commission. It's hard to quantify it because it gets blurred again, you know, don't
yeah.
you think?
Yeah, and there's you know, links some ways and not other ways. And you know, yeah, I know what you're saying.
Perhaps and look, Bill Owl and that, and it gets personal and it gets, the lines get blurred between commission and personal and money, people owing money.
Yeah. Yeah, look, we'll go with one last one. We've just hit 12:30. That's half an hour. Here's another question that I'll give to you because of your age. Are there gangsters alive today who are able to enjoy the fruits of their labour openly? It's a tough one to answer.
It is a tough one. There are. Not a lot. Most of them get banged up, as we say.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of, there are one or two, and you can't name them because they are able to.
Well, if they're at that point where they get into the latter life, then they've probably either, you know,
legitimized
themselves to a point where we probably shouldn't be, you know, insinuating they've done anything wrong. But I'm sure there are people out there who would know.
And again, when you go back to some of the Italian mafia and things, people have never been picked up who are very, very high level. Yeah, there are, and there's probably been people have been importing. That, and they're not names that you know, and that is always the test. In fact, I was very briefly a NOM, which was the infiltration of the phone network used by criminals, allegedly by criminals. I was speaking to a New South Wales cop who said the frightening thing was there were a whole lot of people there whose names we'd never heard.
Yeah.
So that shows you there are people who are flying totally under the radar. I know guys in the 80s who, when, you know, if you got caught with drugs, it was, you'd do 2-3 years. And they were buying huge amounts of property. And it was almost like they would come out with blocks of flats in the eastern suburbs. So yeah, and they'd be enjoying the fruits of their labour from way back then, or just did a couple of years.
Yeah, there's a question here, because it's something that we discussed recently, was that, it's again from Lebo Memes. They say, what are your thoughts on the notion that your articles are resulting in fueled tensions and violence on the streets? Which is something I think when the War 2 came out, we were accused of. I know police thought it was laughable, which is probably what I thought was a good sign, because we never want to be involved. Despite what people probably think about how closely linked to the underworld we are, I don't think either of us have any interest in actually being in...
fueling any sort of violence.
That life, or fueling violence. No. And that's what... And I go back to what we said before about how
there
we...
There are some people who really believe that, but as you say, I think these people...
Well, I mean, you look at... I think what the claims were was... one of them was what I just told you. You know, that story we just mentioned before about Jamie Goodworth.
Yes.
You know, he died, and I know there was claims, oh, look, this is because of the... I don't know the last time we've written a story about the Finks.
And, yeah, that's right, yeah.
So, yeah, I think that's... It's not... Yeah, we don't really think about it too much, but I just thought it was wrong. I know police thought it was
wrong.
We
do worry about... Like, we've actually talked about... bit of a problem between the Houches and the Alamedines allegedly been going on after the Comancheros, and like we talk about those tensions are out there. We're not fueling them,
no,
I don't think, but I mean that they might think differ.
Last one, it's racing season, Moz. Championships are on at Randwick.
Yes.
I'm sure you've been watching on a Saturday afternoon. This person wants to know, what about horse racing? And I guess the question is about horse racing in the underworld. Are they separate worlds or do they intersect? And the obvious one would be Damien Flower, right?
Damien Flower, yeah. And I think that's it's a bit of an aberration. Back years ago, I actually believe if I'd done some racing reporting back in the 80s and 90s, I would have made a lot more crime connections. It was rife. It really was. It has really been cleaned up.
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't think it's anywhere near the way it was. It was really dirty in the 80s and 90s. And a lot of cops who were on the take they were found to have shares in lots of horses.
Yeah.
You would find, yeah, but I think, you know, Damien Flower is a bit of an aberration. You've got to remember, he got his money from way before, and then he started investing it, and then he got in strife. So I think...
not massive anymore, is your answer?
No.
Okay. All right, well, that's been 35 minutes.
Wow.
Thank you very much, Moz. That went quickly.
Yeah, thank you. That was good.
Yeah, and thank you...
Well, we'll see.
We'll say thank you to everyone out there who asked the question. If you ever want to get in touch, you can find us at mark.morri@news.com.au or joshua.hanrahan@news.com.au. But thank you very much for watching and getting involved. And yeah, maybe we'll do this again soon, or maybe someone else will.
Yeah, or maybe we won't do it again.
Maybe we won't.
Thanks.